Greetings, everybody. Welcome to G4G here on YouTube. Happy Eve of Christmas Eve. It's December 23rd. And since we are nearing the end of the year, let us go ahead and talk about Bethesda and Fallout 76 as the shit that keeps on shitting. Obviously, the phrase is the gift that keeps on giving, but for Fallout 76, there is no gift in this. There is no goodwill. This is the turd that keeps on turning. Let's go ahead and wrap up G4G for the year, or probably close to one of the last videos I'll do for the year, and talk about 2018's absolutely biggest tire fire that you can imagine, and it's Fallout 76. So, first thing that I want to state here is, you know, what is my general opinion of Fallout 76 prior to it coming out? To be honest, I was close to getting it. Like, when I saw the announcement and, you know, saw the trailers and everything, of course, the trailers look beautiful, and the thought of a MMO-style Fallout could have been very interesting. I'm not saying I bought it hook, line, and sinker, but not as a fish, but I just kind of, as a human, hooked a pinky on that hook and said, all right, I'm just going to hold you in place. Don't pull me anywhere. I'm not pulling you anywhere, and I'm not letting you go yet. I'm just going to hang here for a little bit, just a little bit of tug on the line. And then Bethesda had Fallout 76 start showing up on this launcher. More on this launcher in a little bit, but this is the Bethesda launcher, and I am a Quake Champions player. However, at the time, I was probably more on the launcher for the Elder Scrolls Legends card game, which I used to at least log into every day, but not necessarily play every day. Now, pretty much, I log into Quake Champions every day, but Quake Champions recently had a patch. We are not getting the daily login bonus. I need to go investigating that because I'm really not happy with this big, big update that they did to Quake that has changed just so much. Anyway, Fallout 76, as you can see, is down here because you can reorder it the way that you want. And I am actually going to put it even lower than it is. It used to be the number one spot. And every time I would pop over to the launcher, there would be Fallout 76 stuff here, pre-order. And I admit I came close. But I kind of chilled out a little bit. I'm like, all right, look, I got through most of 3, and then I stopped. And I never did Vegas, and I got through a chunk of 4, and I stopped. And Battle for Azeroth is going to launch. I was like, no, I'm not going to pre-order. Let me see how it's going to go. That is the smartest don't pre-order decision I've ever made outside of Aliens Colonial Marines. Like, right around the time of Aliens Colonial Marines, Borderlands 2 was coming out. ACM was coming out. I panicked for a moment. I was like, oh my god, which is the one that I pre-ordered? I was interested in both. I hope it's not ACM. Sure enough, it wasn't. It was Borderlands 2. Obviously that was a very good decision there, even though ACM did fix itself, but again, more on that a little bit later. I did not get Fallout 76 pre-order, and my god, am I super happy that I didn't. So what I'm going to be playing is the Fallout Vault game that is on mobile devices. This is my Android copy. If they allowed you to sync up your other versions with a main, like the Steam version or their launcher version with this, I'd probably do it. This is actually Bethesda at its finest. This game is fairly inexpensive. It was to be a hype thing for Fallout 4, but it has managed to get its own existence after that. It's a good game. It's fun. It doesn't rake you over the coals for monetization. I don't even think it's really that pay to win. I've spent so little money on this game, but when you do spend money on it, you get just so much for it. Unlike everything else right now, but this is a fun game, and this, I actually used to play this pretty much daily for a long, long time. I've kind of fallen out of it lately. It's probably not even going to load, but we'll see. So let's go through the history of what Fallout 76 has done from top to bottom. Now, mind you, I've been wanting to do a video on Fallout 76 for a long, long time now. The issue was that it's not going to work. Okay. All right, we'll back out and try it again. The issue was, much like Donald J. Trump, the President of the United States, whether you like him or not, he's constantly in the news. Just about every day, that self-centered little shit is in the news every single day with something or other. ISIS, government shutdown, whatever it is, he's in there nearly daily. You never get a run of not dealing with him. Well, that was what was happening with Fallout 76. You couldn't ever really wrap up their problems because it was just every day there was a new one going on. So the first thing that we have with Fallout 76 is Bethesda said, all right, you know what, Steam? We are not going to put this game on the Steam store. We're going to do it on our own launcher. And everybody went, shit, okay. So you're doing the EA Origin thing. Lovely. Okay. Well, that just sucks. Now, a lot of content creators, a lot of YouTubers at the time, basically came out and said, sucks, we're tired of these alternative launchers, it should be Steam, blah, blah, blah. Now, I'm not one that particularly bitches about alternative launchers. Most of those content creators looped Blizzard in with it, and I really don't complain about the Blizzard launcher. My girlfriend and I discussed this one a lot, mostly because of the fact that it seems like Blizzard fans tend to do Blizzard products quite excessively. You play so many Blizzard products that launcher just comes in super, super handy because it just goes through all of its games together. And if somebody's on HOTS and somebody's on Overwatch, you can message them. I think it's a good launcher. Now, this Bethesda launcher, I don't think is necessarily bad, but in some ways it's underpowered. It doesn't really have a chat client. I think it's neat. I think it's tidy. The links up top are unfortunately very misleading, and you're going to see what's going to happen here. See, it is launching a browser to do these things up here. And it doesn't launch within the launcher, which means just more memory that your computer's using up and everything. And the first time you do it, it's a little bit of a surprise. Like, I click streams earlier, and it, instead of launching like some thumbnails or a video over here, kind of like the Blizzard one, it launched a browser and tried to take me to the Bethesda channel on Twitch. That's where this launcher falls down a little bit. It just isn't as feature-rich. And obviously, the Steam store is the way to go. If it was available on both, where you could copy a code over to Steam and do it on both, that would be really the best way to do it. However, this is isolated only to the Bethesda launcher, which means it's going to be harder if you are totally into Steam and, you know, everything has to be on Steam for you because that's where all your friends are and everything. I would like to think Discord is taking people away from that enough that they don't have to live on Steam anymore. You know, kind of that lineage from Xfire, Steam, the Discord, everything like that. I don't think you have to be on Steam. But, understandably so, people's libraries are huge. They like the pop-up chat window. They like screenshots, overlays. So that was number one. At the time, Bethesda was saying that they were going to leverage Sony and say, we're not going to give you this game if you don't enable crossplay. Now, everybody was like, yay, Bethesda's sticking up for the little guy, and, oh, wait a minute. What game are we using to leverage this? The card game? You're going to try to leverage Sony with the Elder Scrolls Legends not having crossplay? Is that what you're going to do? No, Bethesda, that's not really going to work. And that's pretty much what happened. It was not a strong enough leveraging spot for Bethesda to really do much against Sony whatsoever. So people were kind of thinking like, yay, Bethesda's going to be a little bit of a hero, and nah, not so much. So after this, what do we have next? Well, one of the next things we have is the fact that the beta was so close to the release of the actual game, there is no way on earth that Bethesda would have had enough power, enough time, to take what they learned from the beta and put it into the live game before it came out. And it's unfortunate, because that's what wound up happening, is that there was many, many problems with the beta, and they did transfer over to launch, and Bethesda didn't have enough time to fix them. But before that, before people could even get into the beta to test it, the launcher choice comes and bites Bethesda right on the ass. So what happens there is that Bethesda puts it up on their launcher. People who had pre-ordered it and were in the beta started getting the download available for the game. Now, this happens fairly frequently, where a game company will allow you to pre-order something and have it being downloaded to you digitally before it goes live. And there is a reason for that. It's because you don't wind up chewing up your beta play time downloading the product. You have it downloaded, but they know they're not going to connect it to their servers. So you can just go ahead and start right from moment one that, hey, the game is live. I've got it downloaded already. It's 4:00. It's live. I'm just going to push this button, and voila, I can now play the game. Well, people who had downloaded it on the day that the beta was going to go live, they went and clicked on their launcher, and it said you have an update, and if you tried to update Fallout 76, it backed out all of the download you had done, which I believe was 50-something gigs. And what it did was it made you re-download it from scratch while the beta was live. Now, this causes several problems. You're missing playtime, and not only are you missing playtime, if you're in countries where internet service providers monthly have caps, well, now you've got a major issue, because 50 gigabytes probably chewed up a good amount of your data in a month, and now you have to turn around and get it again. And Bethesda tried to be like, no, wait, don't hit the button. Hit it. It was an absolute nightmare. It was a complete and utter shit show. People were not able to get into the beta when they wanted, because they had to re-download everything. Bad. So now you have the decision to have it be on their own launcher, bite them in the ass, number one. Then during the beta, people realize, all right, look, the creation engine's got some problems. We destroyed a server by dropping 3 nukes. The server shut down, or the shard shut down and crashed. Walking speed in the game is tied to FPS, frames per second. Can you imagine that? Now, in 3 and 4, where it existed, nobody really cared, even if it was noticed, and modders had fixed it. So your walking speed was determined by how good your refresh rate was. You, as a 90 FPS person, had an advantage over somebody who was 50. You could probably just outrun somebody chasing you. You could chase something down that's trying to get away from you. It was there, but nobody cared because it was a single-player experience. When you're playing online as a multiplayer, massively online game and everything like that, you have now a distinct advantage if you have a better PC over somebody who has a weaker PC. You can chase them down and catch up to them, and you can also run away because it's not 60 feet per minute that you're walking. It's now 90 as compared to somebody who is 30, so you're just going to pull ahead of them. I mean, think of two cars on a highway. One doing 60, one's doing 30. Guess what's going to happen? So that was a terrible, terrible bug to go live with, and apparently one that Bethesda's known about and has been in their games for a ridiculously long period of time. Then people start looking around in the beta and realizing, wait a minute, there's no NPCs. So this immersive world is now ridiculously non-immersive because unless you run into other people, which is random, you're not really, there's like very little storytelling. The quests seem to be pretty generic and everything like that. Nothing is really fun about the game unless you manage to play with friends. If you are playing with friends and you're able to do it consistently, then it's apparently not too bad. But if you are trying to do the solo thing and the fact that every time you log in, you're on a different shard and you're like you're what you've affected in the outside world doesn't really stick, and you could, you know, drop a camp and it won't be there the next time you log in, that really began to bug people and get to them. And the criticism came in harsh and fast that it's only really good if you get to play with friends, which is tough to do. Then the server performance was absolute shit, and of course you had nukes that could crash servers. The launcher, yeah, you know, mixed bag. It doesn't have a lot of features, but I'm okay with the Bethesda launcher, but the less amount of launchers I could have up at a given period of time is just less RAM and the web processes that they use and everything like that. On my main computer, it's just Steam. You know, unless I'm in a Blizzard game that needs the launcher, or, you know, used to be Origin was up if I was doing Titanfall 1 and 2. More 2 than 1 for that. Then you have the pre-order bonuses, and this one is the one where Bethesda really blew up in the press. So if you got the $200 pre-order, among all the gifts that you got, two of them were super serious. One of them was the voice-changing helmet. The other one was what appeared to be a canvas, military-ish kind of duffel bag. Well, when people got their pre-orders, a lot of people discovered the helmet just didn't work and was cheap plastic. And then they realized, wait a minute, this is not the bag and all of the promo pictures and everything like that. And it wound up being a cheap piece of shit nylon, not canvas. People tried to get returns for the game. Bethesda really cracked down on it and was like, no. People said, all right, I pre-ordered this and expected a canvas bag. I have this tent material, this windbreaker shit. I don't want this. I want to return it. And they're like, nope, you opened the product. You can't do it. And then their customer support gets in trouble. One customer support had said, there was a shortage of the materials that were planned to be used for the canvas version. Thereby, we produced this version. There is nothing that could be done. Bethesda then tweeted, oh, that's just a contract person. You know, it's like, look, you're obviously doing damage control here. you know full well that what that person said was right, at least in that there's nothing can be done about it. Like, clearly, we know that's going to be true. But yeah, it just seems absolutely ridiculous what was happening at that time in regards to, you know, returning the pre-orders and all that. And many, many videos came out about the bag. And when the bag kind of started to die down a little bit and Bethesda started to offer compensation, more on that in a moment, videos got released saying that really, really good bags, not the canvas bags, but really, really good bags, better than what the pre-order people got, were sent to influencers. So YouTubers and any personality that was associated with Bethesda and everything got this really nice bag. So we know that they could produce them. They just chose not to. And they really, really scrimped on things. So the first thing that they said was, okay, if you want a, you know, money back for this or whatever, we will gift you 500 atoms. If you look in the Fallout 76 store, apparently 500 atoms is worth a real life conversion of $5, $4.99, which is absolutely awful that people paid $200-something for that pre-order and were basically getting the equivalent of $5 worth of in-game currency. Not only that, there is a replica of the actual canvas bag in-game for 700, so you can't even get yourself a digital reminder of how Bethesda's so bad with their free offering. You would have had to convert another $2. Which, let me tell you, is pathetic PR at its best. But it doesn't stop. After the helmet thing is going on and maybe starting to blow over and, you know, everything got refreshed with the YouTubers got a good bag, it started to die and then the ticket thing happened. So if you're not familiar with the ticket thing, people were going to the support. So Bethesda set themselves up to fail for this. They said if anybody wants to discuss, you know, refunds with the product, especially the canvas bag pre-order, email the support email address, which will make a ticket. They drove so much traffic to their ticketing system that a user on Reddit logged in and discovered that they could not only see their open ticket, they could see everybody's ticket. And they could even comment in them and close them. Pretty quickly, it was confirmed that it was real, but Bethesda, within about 2 or 3 hours, shut the ticketing system down. However, the damage was done. People jokingly had tickets closed with hysterical results and everything like that. And what seems to be the case is that probably the ticket tech role got applied to the whole database. So there's the customer role and then there's the technician role, and probably everybody became a technician or everybody had a slightly different customer role than you would typically see. I have an outside vendor at my job, and when other users in my organization open a ticket with them, they can see themselves. I and one or two others can see all of the tickets because I work in technology. So I'm allowed to see all the open tickets that my people have opened with this vendor. That is probably something that happened. They were probably either given a high administrator technician type of thing or a special customer role that allows them to see more than just their own. Whatever it was, that's probably what happened. The damage that was done by exposing this data, even though it wasn't passwords, it was receipts, it was last four of credit card, it was real names, it was addresses. That is a major GDPR violation in Europe. That is an exposure of private data. Even if it's an accident, they could very well get sued or potentially even class action lawsuit by Europeans affected by this. This is a very, very serious breach that they had over there. Moving on from that, a patch rolled out that was supposed to fix things, and everybody kind of discovered, wait, things just got a little bit harder to grind. Like, I'm not leveling as fast over here. And similar to the Destiny thing, and you would think Bethesda would have learned from that because they had a company go before them a year ago where they were not very upfront about undocumented changes and the problems of the experience getting out of control for Destiny 2. You would think Bethesda wouldn't pull something like that, but they unfortunately did. So people were upset about that. People were upset about the fact that end bosses were basically Skyrim reskins. I believe a final dragon type boss in Fallout 76 is a reskinned Ember Beast from Skyrim. That's bad. Like, it's one thing to keep reusing assets in your own IP or game universe when you have them cross over like that. That's just pretty ridiculous. The fact that you could dupe items in the game was a big thing. Yeah, apparently old school, like Diablo-esque duping is a thing that you can do in the game. Then, after the data regulation thing came out, of course there was that experience bug and everything like that, and they just were not communicating well with the public at all. You were seeing mixed information in regards to whether refunds could be granted. Everybody was covering them all the time. I mean, you couldn't walk 3 feet in YouTube without somebody talking about Bethesda's craziness for the day. Now we come up to another issue. There was apparently a tie-in called Nuka-Cola Rum, where it was a dark rum that seemed to be in a kind of spaceshipy looking bottle, all black. It was rum. Obviously, it's not going to be produced by Bethesda, but the Fallout 76 name was tied to the rum. Clearly a collector's edition. Well, apparently, it has been delayed to people over a month from the original ship date with mild, at best, communication from Bethesda as to what's going on. And they were like, here, and this is a video I saw on a channel called YTE. If you're looking for the original, that's where you want to go. Go to YTE. He was like, okay, so they sent me this video to keep me hyped while they're fulfilling the order and everything. It clearly shows, without them hiding it, that it is a bottle of rum that is placed in a plastic rocket shell as if it is a container, a shipping container or a hard case for a Nintendo Switch. You have the bottom half of the plastic, the bottle is put in it, a giant fake bottle cap is put on top, and then the top is like snapped in. So it's not even that it was shaped as a bottle in the shape of a Nuka-Cola rocket kind of a deal. It's just a bottle inside of a plastic shell. A cheap plastic shell rather than a blown glass bottle shaped appropriately. Now you could argue, well, that's just assumption that you're getting a glass. It seems to be everybody that has looked at that little rum that could be pre-ordered knows full well that they really thought they were getting a glass bottle in the shape of a Nuka-Cola rocket. So, much like the duffel bag, this is a clear case of bait and switch yet again. And it's going to be very, very interesting to see how Bethesda handles any refunds on that. Because if you're looking to get a piece, and it's $80 a pop, I believe. So if you're looking to, if you're so into the Fallout games and like you have a, I don't know, an ogre tattoo on your back, or a Pip-Boy tattooed on your wrist, or you have the Pip-Boy theme on your phone or whatever, I can imagine you being really hyped for this Fallout branded rum, only to find out it's just a weak-ass plastic shell. It's clear that Bethesda just doesn't know good PR and doesn't give a shit about their games anymore. People were so hyped for Starfield that I've talked to a lot of people, including a coworker, who has said, I'm now scared of Starfield. I was looking forward to it. I don't know that I'm interested in doing it anymore because Fallout 76 is such an utter shit show. And, you know, sadly, she'd be right. Like, how do you continue to trust a company like Bethesda that is so tone deaf and so out of touch with what made them good and seem like one of the good guys? I don't know. Like, I would like them to just take Fallout 76 and, you know what, disappear it. Maybe give people their money back and just disappear it, sort of like Final Fantasy XIV. Unfortunately, you have examples like No Man's Sky, where a patch has brought what was a universally panned and miserably reviewed and miserably played game into something that a lot of people are saying is actually pretty good now. The fix for Alien Colonial Marines that took that from being a dumpster fire into something good apparently was one line of code with a misspelling. Once the misspelling was fixed, suddenly the alien AI was intelligent, as they had originally intended, and the game is a little bit more fun. These things might buoy Bethesda into holding out into Fallout 76 and go, we'll patch the shit out and we'll make it good. Well, that's a scary prospect because code has been revealed in the game's files that originally those perk cards might have been loot boxes. Not only that, there might actually be loot boxes coming to a game that people have just been happy doesn't have a loot box. Now, it might be an event or something seasonal, but nobody wants loot boxes in this game, and Bethesda might put it there. That's bothering people, and it is scaring them, and it's really sad to hear it's just another thing with Bethesda. So for me, from what I know, the Nuka-Cola rum is the latest of the debacles over there. Whether we see another one before the beginning of the new year, I don't know. But Bethesda, I just really want them to pack the game up and quietly do the Homer fading into the hedge routine over here. They probably won't, but to me, I almost think the only way they could get goodwill out there is give people a refund and just close the game down, hack and slash it, burn it to the ground, and just dump it. But Bethesda probably won't. They'll think that they'll continue to fix it and everything like that. I don't know if they're going to have the subs or anything, but really, really, really bad end half of the year for Bethesda here, mostly on the backs of Fallout 76. So what do you guys think about Fallout 76? Do any of you guys play it? Do you find the only way to have fun is to play it with... Oh, Jesus Christ. Fucking Deathclaws. Hate Deathclaws. Goodbye. Do you think Fallout 76 is only enjoyable if played with friends? Have you bought the game and dumped it? Did you cancel your pre-order? Let me know what you think of the game. And let's talk about it. Thanks, everybody. Have a good one.